All right, we're going to deal with, in this lesson, we're going to deal with the Minoans. Now, the Minoans were of the seed of Japhet, you know. They were part of the inhabitants that inhabited, like, certain ones of those islands, like Crete and other islands like that. And Japhet, you know, they inhabited the islands, and they inhabited also up in what's called today Europe, all right. And these people were dark-skinned people, but then Esau moved in, which is a so-called white man, and took over. And that's why you see today in history books, you see the majority of people that live in Europe are so-called Caucasians or so-called white people. All right, now before we get started, I just want to read something real quick here. I believe it's in All right, so now I want to just read this real quick in the book of Genesis 10 and 1 down to about the fifth verse. It says, now these are the just to show you that Japhet not only inhabited Europe, but they also inhabited the islands and like in the Mediterranean Sea. It says, now these are the generations of the sons of Noah, Shem, Ham, and Japhet, and unto them were sons born after the flood. The sons of Japhet, Gomer, and Magog, and Madai, and Javan, and Tubal, and Meshach, and Tyrus. Now we're going to go over this verse again a little later, but I'm just trying to get to the main point right now just to show you something. And the sons of Gomer, Ashkenaz, and Riphath, and Togarmah, and the sons of Javan, Elisha, and Tarshish, Kittim, and Dodanim. By these were the isles of the Gentiles divided in their lands. See? So the isles, which is the islands that like you see in the Mediterranean Sea, you know, those were inhabited by Japhites also. And up into Europe also. They inhabited that land also, because that's what the portion of land that was given to them. So it says, by these were the isles of the Gentiles divided in their lands, every one after his tongue, after their families and their nations. Now we're going to get back to this, but I just want to make that point just so you can know that the people that were in the island, they call them seafaring people, you know, the Japhites that were there, those were Japhites, and also the ones that were on the mainland like Greece, you know, Rome, you know, what they call today France, you know, all in different lands that you see in Europe today. Now there's this website here by this guy named Dr. Kwame Nantumbo, right? And this is the website here. Now, you know, he goes off into that African thing, you know, because he doesn't know any better. You know, he thinks, you know, that Jake is Africans, but he did research and he found out that there was a lot of different historical facts that showed that people of these lands were really people of color. Now, he calls them all Africans, but we know the difference in the distinction because of the fact that you had all the people that came out of Ham were all dark-skinned people. They were all black people, you know. But then down the line, when Esau came in, Esau was the one that was different. That's why it gave a color of Esau being red. So now this is posted on June 15, 2001. Now as you read through here, like I said, it gives you different, you know, instances of where so-called Africans, quote-unquote, had conquered certain lands, and they lived in certain lands prior to the so-called Caucasians or the Edomites getting in there. And on some parts he goes off, but you know, he's pretty much on point with a lot of his information. So now as you scroll through here, he breaks it down by numbers. So when you get down to number 11, it says the ancient Greeks were a dark people. Let me read that again. The ancient Greeks were a dark people. Sir Arthur Evans, the excavator of the Minoan sites, shocked Western scholars when he uncovered this fact in 1894, hidden among the ruins of the ancient Crete. According to Evans, the Grecians whom we discern in the new dawn were not pale-skinned northerners, but essentially a dark-skinned, brown-complexioned race. See? I mean, I'm going to read that whole thing again. It says, the ancient Greeks. Now, this guy, Sir Arthur Evans, I'm going to show you a picture of him. He's a cracker. And he excavated this stuff, you know, in the island of Crete. As, you know, you see the picture of the island of Crete. That was one of the places where the Minoans lived. And then you had other people that were related to them that didn't live on that island. They lived all throughout the Mediterranean. They lived in Greece. They lived in other parts of Europe, the so-called Hawaiians today. You know, the Japhites. Alright, Hawaiians and Samoans, those are the Japhites. You're going to see that. Now, this guy here, this is Sir Arthur Evans. Now, if you read through this article here, as you see here, I didn't really read through it. I just got it for his picture. I'm sure they're not going to mention that the people that he discovered their wall frescoes and all that were black. He's not going to tell you that. But this guy here, he said, the ancient Greeks were a dark people. Sir Arthur Evans, the excavator of the Minoan sites, shocked Western scholars when he uncovered this fact in 1894, hidden among the ruins of ancient Crete. According to Evans, the Grecians whom we discern in the New Dawn were not pale-skinned northerners, but essentially a dark-skinned, brown-complexioned race. You see? So the reason why I said northerners was because by that time, Esau had already been infiltrating into Europe, you know. And today, what you see today is them so-called white people that inhabit Europe. They're not the original people of those lands. So basically, he said that the Minoans, which were ancient Greeks, were dark people. Now I have here a picture, right? This is Knossos Crete Palace Guide, page 1. This is where he did his excavations at. And now, if you see here in this picture here, you have Minoan art, wall mural, Knossos, Crete. Now you have some pictures that are black and you have some pictures that are white. Now does that mean that you have black and you have white Minoans? No, because this asshole, false prophet 666, said that why is it when you look at certain Japhetic artwork, some of them are black and some of them are white? Because that's what you see right here, right? Now we're going to find what the reason why some of them are black and some of them are white. Was it because some of them were Caucasian, because Japhet was white? No. Japhet was so-called black people, as we just read this guy, Sir Arthur Evans, just stated. Right? So now if you come here to the Wikipedia, the Free Encyclopedia, under the Minoan Civilization, it says the Minoan civilization, a Bronze Age civilization, arose on the island of Crete and flourished from approximately 27th century BC to the 15th century BC. It was rediscovered at the beginning of the 20th century through the work of a British archaeologist, Sir Arthur Evans. Will Durant referred to it as the first link in the European chain. See? The first link in the European chain. Why? Because of the fact that these people discovered were the actual inhabitants, the first inhabitants of what is called today Europe. Now as you scroll down here to overview, it says the Minoan people were not Indo-European. They were related to the pre-Greek dwellers of Greek mainland in western Anatolia, the so-called Pelasgians. Now this brother, or Pelagians, however the hell you pronounce it. Now this brother, I believe his name is Tazamak from South Carolina Israelites. He did a show. Esau moved in and pushed and shoved Japheth out, and he touched on these Pelagians or Pelasgians or whatever the hell they are, and he showed that they were dark-skinned people, that they were Japhites. Now these people, these Minoans, they are also related to the Pelasgians or Pelagians. The Minoan people were not Indo-European. They were related to the pre-Greek dwellers of the Greek mainland in western Anatolia, the so-called Pelasgians or Pelagians. Right? So notice it says here, it was rediscovered, talking about the island of Crete, it was rediscovered at the beginning of the 20th century through the work of the British archaeologist Sir Arthur Evans. Will Durant referred to it as the first link in the European chain. So these are the people that first inhabited Europe. All right, now as we scroll down here to society and culture, it says Minoan men wore loincloths and kilts. And you see those so-called Samoans, you know, the Hawaiians, Samoans, Hawaiians, I can't think of all their names now, the so-called Polynesian people today, the Tongans and all that. You see that they wear what? They wear kilts, they wear loincloths, because that's a part of their dress. Women wore robes that had short sleeves and layered flounced skirts. These were open to the navel, allowing their breasts to be left exposed. And then if you know anything about these islands, like in the movie, The Bounty with Anthony Hopkins and Mel Gibson, they show you in that movie, itself that the Hawaiian women, when Anthony Hopkins and Mel Gibson and them landed on that island that they were in, they show you that the women they didn't cover their breasts, and the men had loincloths. Why? Because those are the actual inhabitants that inhabited Europe, and then when they were pushed out, they were forced to move out into those different places. Now I'm gonna show you this real quick. This quick clip of the movie The Bounty. See the titties hanging out? See the little skirts that they're wearing? See? They didn't cover themselves up. The women didn't cover themselves up on the top. This is a real Japhite right here. And if you watch the movie, they show you that the men also wore loincloths. Alright, that's why it says here, it says Minoan men wore loincloths and kilts. Women wore robes that had short sleeves and layered flounced skirts. These were open to the navel, allowing their breasts to be exposed. Perhaps during ceremonial occasions, women also had the option of wearing strapless fitted bodice, the first garments known in history. You know, and it gives you the manner of dress that the women had, right? Some of them they still know, some of them they don't know about. It says the Minoan religion focused on female deities with females officiating. The statues of priestesses in Minoan culture and frescoes showing men and women participating in the same sports such as bull leaping led some archaeologists to believe that men and women held equal social status. Inheritance is thought to have been matrilineal. The frescoes include many depictions of people with the genders distinguished by color. So the genders, male and female, were distinguished by what? By color. The men's skin is reddish brown, the women's white. So they were all brown-skinned people, but when they painted frescoes or any types of painting of themselves, they would distinguish the genders by color. That's why you had the men that looked dark, you know, a brownish color, and then you had the women that looked white, like in this picture here. Fresco showing three women who were possibly queens. And you notice that the women's skin color is white. Why? Because that was to distinguish the difference between the men and the women. Because if you look at the men, they had long hair and they looked like women. See the woman with the long hair? But that's how they distinguished the two of them. Not that they were white Japhites and black Japhites. They were all black. But in art, they distinguished the genders by skin color. Or by color, which you see right here. Again, it says, the frescoes include many depictions of people with the genders distinguished by color. The men's skin is reddish brown, the women's white. Why? Just to distinguish the two genders. All right, that's the reason why sometimes when you see these Japhite pictures, some of them are brown skin and some of them look white. All right, now, I have a little clip here to show you. This is Sinking Atlantis. They bring out some points and they go off on others. So we just want to show you.
5,000 years ago, the great civilization of the Minoans flourished on the island of Crete. Centuries before the Greeks built the Parthenon, Minoan artists recorded their achievements with exquisite carvings and beautiful frescoes.
Look at that, dark-skinned people.
The Minoans were the first Europeans to use writing.
First Europeans, you heard what he said, right? First Europeans.
But then, at the height of their power,
women. See, that's a woman.
They were wiped from the pages of history. Their disappearance is still one of the ancient world's greatest mysteries.
Why the distinguished gender?
Some thought the Minoans were slaughtered by invaders. Others that a volcanic eruption had engulfed them. But now, a team of scientists is looking for more definitive answers. Their research is casting doubt on previous theories and unearthing new evidence of an unexpected natural disaster.
You spend a lot of time looking for something, and then when you find it, you wish you hadn't.
Yeah, you wish you hadn't, because you found out that the original inhabitants of Europe were really black, not white. All right, the Japhites, the original Japhites, were dark skin. Now he's trying to use that saying, what he just said, because they found out that they supposedly got wiped out by a tsunami or whatever. But we know what he really meant. He really meant that you do all this digging and research, and then when you find out the truth, you kind of wish you didn't. That's what he's saying, because of the fact that they found out through Sir Arthur Evans, that the archaeologists that dug up the island of Crete, that the original inhabitants of Europe were actually dark-skinned people, not white.
Did the Minoans' terrible fate give rise to the famous myth of Atlantis, the ancient city that vanished beneath the waves? More than 2,000 years ago, the Greek historian Plato wrote about Atlantis, the fabled civilization that was swallowed by the sea. But the origins of Plato's story have never been identified. It is only recently that some archaeologists have begun to believe the legend may have started here on Crete.
Look at that.
They are hoping that scientific investigation can provide an actual link to Plato's ancient folk memory.
Look at that.
It's an ambitious goal, given that our modern understanding of the Minoans is sparse, called in large part from Greek myths about monsters and human sacrifice.
Now, if you notice, that some of those pictures, they have like kind of like a little bit of straight kind of curly hair. That's the same type of hair that these Hawaiians, Samoans, Tongans, and all them have, because those are the modern day Japhites. All right, now this is another picture showing the woman with her breasts out, which is the same way that these women would, dress back, during that time. I want to read this real quick, then I got a couple of scriptures I'm going to hit. Try to make this lesson as short as possible. But this is you can see it right here, this website here. It's called DNA Analysis Has Cleared Up the Origins of the Etruscans. Tuscany's name in modern day comes from the Etruscans, a very advanced ancient civilization, highly influential in the development of the early Roman civilization. Now, anybody that knows anything about research knows that the Etruscans were Japhites, all right? But the origins of the Etruscan civilization has been a vivid debate amongst archaeologists, historians, and linguists for centuries. And then you brothers, if you want, you can read this whole, thing. It's kind of short, but I'm just going to go to the main point. It says, the Lydian theory also links the Etruscans to the Minoans and people of the sea, seafaring raiders that were at war with the Egyptians in the 12th century BC. So basically, the Etruscans and the Minoans are the same people. That's why this guy over here, Sir Arthur Evans, said the ancient Greeks were a dark people. Sir Arthur Evans, the excavator of the Minoan site, shocked Western scholars when he uncovered this fact in 1894, hidden among the ruins of the ancient Crete. According to Evans, the Grecians whom we discern in the new dawn were not pale-skinned northerners, but essentially a dark-skinned brown complexion race. Then here, when we read about the Minoans, this guy here, Will Durant, said he referred to it as the first link in the European chain. What is the first link in the European chain? The excavation that Sir Arthur Evans excavated on the island of Crete. And then this guy over here, he said you spend a whole lot of time doing a lot of research, and when you find out this research, you wish you hadn't found it out. So it says the Lydian theory also links the Etruscans to the Minoans and the people of the sea, seafaring raiders that were at war with the Egyptians in the 12th century BC. Their civilization was centered in Crete, now an island in southern Greece, and other neighboring islands like Lemnos, and these people spoke non-Indo-European related languages. There are significantly increasing proofs that match the Crete and Minoan civilizations to Atlantis and its decline in huge ancient tsunami. Alright, so we think that our research provides convincing proof that Herodotus was right and that the Etruscans did indeed arrive from ancient Lydia. Alright, then he goes into a whole, like I said, if you brothers want to read the whole article. But the main point that I wanted to get was that the Etruscans and the Minoans are related with each other. Alright, this is this website here It's called Welcome to the Real History Worldwide. This is the original black civilization of Crete and Greece, the Minoan and Mycenaean. All right, and then you go through here and you have different maps and you know, and statues and paintings that show you that they were Jakes. Well, not Jakes, but they were dark-skinned people. See the nose, Minoan snake goddess. You got the wide nose. She got this one here. Got like cornrows. Crete lady of Auxerre. This is 650 BC. This is before Jake got up in there. Now, you know, you might have had a couple of Jakes, you know, that got caught up in there because of the diaspora, you know, during the time of the Assyrians, during the time of the Babylonians. But for the most part, they were all Japhites, all right. And as you can see, look at that Minoan fresco. That's a dark-skinned person, all right. And it gives you different, you know, different pictures of different Minoans. All right, and you can go through these. These are the brother brought out, the Pelasgians or the Pelasgians. This is another one, and it shows you that these people were dark-skinned people with cornrows. See, statues of Koros, 590 to 580 BC. All right, and then you know gives you different ones. You know, here you go. This is dark. I got some pictures I want to show you, brother. So I'm not going to spend too much time on these. But this is what I wanted to show you, brother. Matter of fact, before we go on any further, I want to go to the book of Genesis 10, 1 and 2 real quick. It says, "Now these are the generations of the sons of Noah, Shem, Ham, and Japhet. And unto them were sons born after the flood. The sons of Japhet, Gomer, and Magog, and Madai, and Javan, and Tubal, and Meshech, and Tyrus." Now as you read through here, right, it's Banya, Yapath, Gamar, Magawag, Wa Madia, Wa Yawan, all right? Now you hear Wa Yawan, right? They have Javan, but it's, or Yawan, Yavan, but it's Yawan. Now what you have here, Javan, Ionia, or Greece, a son of Japhet and grandson of Noah. Greece, Ionia, Ionians, location of descendants of Javan. So who were there? The first people there, they were dark-skinned people, which were the real Japhites. It says, Ionia from this province being more to the east and better known than the rest of Greece to the Oriental. Its name became applied in their language to the whole of Greece. This has been expressly remarked by Greek writers themselves because they knew the history. The patron, sons of the Greeks, Yawan. See here they got Jawan, but it's really Yawan. All right, so now let's go from there. Now that we got that point, I'm gonna hit another scripture in here. But before I go to this scripture, I want to go back here to this webpage, and here you can see this guy has curly hair, right? You can see he has a dark-skinned person's features, nose. It says Ionian. Persian relief at Apadana, 500 BC. This is an original Ionian. It's not no white person. It's a dark-skinned person. Over here, Helen. Persian relief at Apadana, 500 BC. These are the original inhabitants of Helen. You see, they got the curly beard, the curly hair. And then the Japhites, some of their hair is kind of a little straight. But it's like curlyish, you know. And then they used to straighten their hair, too. So right here is Helen Persian relief at Apadana, 500 BC. So these are more pictures of these Japhites. All right. And like I said, I got a few pictures that I want to show you, brothers, you know, at the end of this lesson. And now this is when Jake got up in there. All right. So there's a distinction there. And then these are the original black civilization of Italy, the Etruscans. You know, all this information is out there, but you have assholes that just look at that. 4000 BC, look at that, a black person, dark-skinned person, not a so-called Negro of America, but a dark-skinned person of that region. All right, there's another one here, as you can see. All right, I'm just trying to show you some of these quick. See, look at that, Etruscan terracotta, that's an Etruscan. All right. This was like in Greek mythology, they had the centaur, which is half man and half like fawn or whatever the hell that thing is. That's what it. That's where those Greeks got that from. They got that myth from the real Etruscans from Japhet. And you see, they're dark black people. Look at that. Look at that. Look at that. Etruscan. That looks like a Japhite, one of them Hawaiians or Samoans. Same with this one. This is the centaur right here. Half man, half horse or something like that. Alright. And this one. Alright, there's not too much on this right here. Alright, so you pretty much get the idea. Now I want to read this other scripture here. Oh, before I do that, before I read that scripture, I want to show you brothers this. Now these are actual Minoans. Alright. This is at Knossos. This is one of the places that this guy excavated, Sir Arthur Evans. And you can see, look at that. Crete Lady of Auxerre, 650 BC. That's a Japhite. The original black civilization of Italy, the Etruscans. Etruscan, 500 to 400 BC. Now, it's possible that this might be a Jake that got up in there, but then you had some, like, real, like, darker complexioned Japhites, too. Some of them were like kind of brownish, like the Samoans and the Hawaiians, but some of them were actually darker too. So it could be a possibility that Jake could have got up in there, you know, through you know the diaspora, mainly of the Babylonian Empire, but or it could just be that he was an actual Etruscan. Now this is I just show you this, the Etruscan terracotta, and these are more pictures. These are men, actual men. That's why they got them brown skin. And that's another picture. Let me bring it up a little bit more. It's pretty much the same picture. This is another Etruscan. It's a Minoan. Minoan, look. That don't look like no white person. That's a dark skin, looks like a Japhite with the curly hair. Look at that, Minoan too. Look at that. That's a dark skin Japhite, Hawaiian. Here's more. Here's more. Look at that. They're all dark skin. Some of them are real dark. Some of them are lighter brown. And some of them, the paintings, they had actual other paintings on top of it. They had the outline, and then they had an actual, like, shellac almost. And you know, over the years, it broke off. That's why you see this one's a little lighter. And you can see these are darker. Some of this stuff, whatever it was that they used for the painting, broke off. Now, this is a woman. Remember what we read about the women? They were distinguished by gender, by color. And not that she was a white woman. She was a dark-skinned woman. But in art, they depicted the women as white because they worshipped them as goddesses. All right? Now, here you go again. You got the dark ones here, and then you got some white ones. These are women. All right? And that's the reason why some of them are dark and some of them are white, to distinguish the gender. The original black civilization of Crete and Greece, the Minoan and Mycenaean. There goes another picture of it. Look at that one, a Minoan fresco. Look at that. Look at that. Look at that. Dark skin. Minoan fresco, I'll just show you that one. I just show you that one too. Look at that. Minoans in Egypt. They were down even in Egypt. Because they were trading all throughout the Mediterranean Sea. So these are Minoans in Egypt. Dark skin. Alright, that's pretty much it on that. Now I'm going to hit a couple of scriptures and then end the lesson with that. So, you know, those of you that don't get it, that the original Japhetic people were dark skin people, then I don't know what to tell you. It's not for you. Just keep stepping. Joel 3:1. For behold, in those days and in that time, when I shall bring again the captivity of Judah and Jerusalem, I will also gather all nations, and I will bring them down in the valley of Jehoshaphat, and will plead with them there for my people and for my heritage Israel, whom they have scattered among the nations and parted my land. Now, I was going to read this whole scripture, but I'm just going to jump to the main point just to show you something real quick. Verse 5. Because you have taken my silver and my gold, and have carried into your temples my goodly pleasant things. Now these were the them Arabs and them Hamites. They came and they snatched us up, and basically they sold us to the so-called white man. All right. It says, behold, It said, the children also of Judah and the children of Jerusalem have you sold unto the Grecians. Now here, when you look up the word for Grecians in the blue letter Bible, which we're in, if you read through there, the word there is Yawonium, okay? Yawonia, right? Which is an Ionian, Greece Ionian. But this is when, by the time that, this is referring to that land. Why? Because when the so-called white men took over that land, they became Greeks. They took on that name upon themselves, okay? Yawonia, right? Which is an Ionian, Greece Ionian. But this is when, by the time that, this is referring to that land. Why? Because when the so-called white men took over that land, they became Greeks. They took on that name upon themselves. That's why you know these Edomites today as Greeks or Grecians, you know, because they took over that part of the world, you know. That's where they really started getting up into to Europe through the Macedonians, which were Edomites. I have this website here, right, and it says Alexandros, Macedon, and Macedonia, right? Now, this guy, he goes into a rant about how the original Macedonians are really, you know, from the Pelasgian and, you know, all them, you know, Pelagian or whatever, you know, them people, the original Japhites were. But it's not true, because the people, well, we'll read it and you know, give, you know, you'll see for yourself. And you, like I said, you can read this. There's a lot of bones in this thing, you know, so if you want to read through, you can read through it. But it's just a couple of points here that I wanted to make, just to show you that the so-called white men that's there today, they're not the original people of that land, all right? Which they're all descendants from Alexander the Greek, which they're all descendants of Alexander the Crete, you know? So they're all the same people, you know? But that's the same thing that's happening over there in the land of Israel. You got one sect of so-called Jews fighting against another sect of so-called Jews, and the one saying that one of them is not the Israelites, and the other one saying that they're not the Israelites, well, neither one of them are Israelites. It says, the world has never tired of speaking about Alexander the Great. But how many people, and especially how many historians, have visited Macedonia and tried to speak with a Macedonian? I'm just going to skip through here a little bit. How many historians have studied the history of the Macedonians and of the Macedonian state from its early foundation to the present day, when it shared between the Greeks, the Bulgarians, Yugoslavians, and the Albanians, each trying to adjudicate a claim for the territory and for the Macedonians? Does anyone care today if today the Macedonians, living in their own country but under a Greek yoke, lead a worse life than under the Ottoman rule? The Greeks do not acknowledge their existence, so do not offer them the well-known rights any minority is entitled to. See, so you have a situation where the people of Greece, which are the same people that conquered Macedonia, they're the same people, but now they're trying to separate themselves from those people of Macedonia, trying to say that those people of Macedonia, they're not actual Greeks, which they're right, but they're not Greeks either, because they're Edomites. So there's this ongoing fight between them. Now it says here, the origin of the Macedonians. It says, why are the Greeks so keen on lying about it when they consider the Macedonians to be Greek, of Greek origin? If their theory is so blatantly wrong, it's a pity, I think. This could make us believe that actually their entire culture may be hiding a well-buried theft long since woven into their history. So that's why they don't want to allow the so-called Macedonians up in there. But it's too late, because everybody knows that Alexander the Crete, who those people in Greece are descendants of, he came from Macedonia. Philip, his father, so big deal. Because that was the beginning of the so-called white man getting into Europe through Greece. All right, I'm just jump down. One more point I want to make in here. It says, one of the descendants of Alexander the First of Macedon was denied participation in the Olympic Games on account of being a barbarian and not a Greek. See? So they were not Japhetic. They were not Japhet. And so like I was saying here in the book of Joel, the third chapter, when it speaks about that the Hamites and them Ishmaelites sold our people to the hand of the Grecians. The reason why they call them Grecians, because by that time they had already taken over this land. Because when did the so-called slave trade start? around the 1500s into the 1600s, which the bulk of the slaves coming over in 1620. So by that time, the so-called white man, the Edomites, had already infiltrated Europe. All right, now I want to go to Genesis, the 27th chapter and the 34th verse, because I want to show you a little something and a comparison that I made. This is Genesis 27:34, and when Esau heard the words of his father, he cried with a great and exceeding bitter cry, and said unto his father, "Bless me, even me also, O my father." Now this is when Jacob got over and got slick and basically stole Esau's birthright, which was already set up in the spirit anyway. And he said, "Thy brother came with subtlety, and hath taken away thy blessings." And he said, "Is not he rightly named Jacob? For he hath supplanted me these two times. He took away my birthright, and behold, now he hath taken away my blessing." And he said, "Hast thou not reserved the blessing for me?" And Isaac answered and said unto Esau, "Behold, I have made him thy lord." See, that's why Esau came under subjection under us, you know, with King David, you know, and the other Judite kings. "And all his brethren have I given to him for servants. And with corn and wine have I sustained him, and what shall I do now unto thee, my son?" And Esau said unto his father, "Hast thou but one blessing, my father? Bless me, even me also, O my father." And Esau lifted up his voice and wept. And Isaac his father answered and said unto him, "Behold, thy dwelling shall be the fatness of the earth, and of the dew of heaven from above. And by thy sword thou shalt live, and shall serve thy brother." See, that's why Esau had to serve us. "And it shall come to pass, when thou shalt have the dominion, that thou shalt break his yoke from off thy neck." Now, I'm going to go here to the book of 2 Chronicles. You know, because there's a couple of scriptures that go into the same topic, but I kind of like the way this one was worded. This is 2 Chronicles 21 and 8. It says, "And in the days... And in his days, the Edomites revolted from under the dominion of Judah." So this is the fulfillment of the prophecy in Genesis, the 27th chapter, where Isaac told Esau, it says, "And by thy sword thou shalt live, and shalt serve thy brother, and it shall come to pass, when thou shalt have the dominion, that thou shalt break his yoke from off thy neck." So it says, "In his days, the Edomites revolted from under the dominion of Judah, and made themselves a king." See? So they made themselves a king. Now, if you type in... list of kings of Edom, there's certain Assyrian and Syrian writings that actually have a list of some of the names of the kings of Edom, which is not really important because it's not really in the scriptures, even though the name king is in there. But they do have a record of some of these kings, you know, of Esau. You know, they used to call them Udum or Edumi, you know, the kings of Edom. All right. It says, "Then Jehoram went forth with his princes and all his chariots with him, and he rose up by night and smote the Edomites which compassed him and the captains of the chariots. So the Edomites revolted from under the hand of Judah unto this day." Now, this right here, this particular incident, this happened after King David and after King Solomon. So this happened around the year 896 B.C., around that, you know, about between 900 and 890 BC, somewhere in that time frame. All right, that's the time when Esau revolted from under the hand of Judah. And you better believe that the Edomites did not stay in the land of Idumea. They were all over the place. They moved, you know, when they were being persecuted, some of them ran. You know, I mean, there's no like straight document right now that proves that, but I bet you if you dig hard enough, you'll find something like that. You know, now this keep in mind, it took place around between 900 and 890 BC, around that time period, right? Now, when you look up the word or the list of the kings of Macedon, right, it says here, "Macedon, also known as Macedonia, was an ancient kingdom centered on the present day region of Macedonia in northern Greece." Right, so now when you look through here, it gives you a time period of the kings that ruled in Macedon, beginning with this guy Caranus, 808 to 778 BC. You see, so this is close to the time. This is about 80-90 years after Esau revolted from under the hands of Judah. So it's very possible that these kings here that ruled in Macedon, because as you go, if you scroll down through here, you're gonna see we just read about this guy Alexander the First. It said one of his descendants was denied access to go into the Olympics because he was not a Greek, you know, because they knew something. And then as you scroll down through here some more, you'll find out what Philip the Second. This is the king of Macedon. This is Alexander the Creek's father. And then you see Alexander the Third, the Great. So they were Macedonian kings. So it's possible that this guy, because this is just the time periods match perfect, you know, with the time when Judah revolted from the hand. I'm sorry, when Esau revolted from under the hand of Judah. And you know they didn't stay there because they had kings. So they moved about. So it's very possible that this guy here could be the first link of Esau taking over Europe. Or it could be that some of these beginning kings here were actually Japhites, which are dark-skinned people. And and down the line somewhere, maybe here or whatever, they could have inserted themselves like they did in Europe. After King James the First, you know, on down the line, with I believe it was Queen Victoria was the last Jake that ruled in England, you know, and the same thing with the other kings, and they just inserted themselves in there and made a proclamation that they were the new people. So it's possible that that could be the case here, or it could be the case that all these kings here were actual Edomite kings because the time frame links up. All right. So I just wanted to bring out that little tidbit, you know, because that kind of ties in to the lesson, because that's why it said that the Hamites and the Ishmaelites sold the children of Israel to the Grecians, because by that time, the time that was going to happen, the so-called white men, the Edomites, were going to be in the land of Greece. That's why when you go to, let me go to the book of Daniel. And we'll go back to that. We go to the book of Daniel real quick, the 5th chapter and the 28th verse. This is when the the Babylonians fell as a nation. All right. So it says here, Perez, thy kingdom is divided and given to the Medes and the Persians. So this is when the Babylonians fell under Belshazzar, and it was given to the Medes and the Persians. These are the people that took over that land after. after the Babylonians had taken over the land. Now, or should I say, after the Babylonian Empire, these people here, the Persians and the Medes, were the next rulers. Now, the Medes were descendants of Japhet, and they were dark-skinned people also. This is the book of Daniel, chapter 9, verse 1. It says, in the first year of Darius, the son of Ahasuerus, of the seed of the Medes. So Darius was also a dark-skinned person. He was of the seed of the Medes. He was a Japhite, which was made king over the realm of the Chaldeans. Why? Because he took over their kingdom through through them falling. All right, now, let's go from there to the book of Daniel, chapter 7. Same book. Just hitting a couple of points. You know, you brothers pretty much already know this. Just hitting a couple of points to to bring this thing home. Daniel 7 and 5, and behold, another beast, a second, like to a bear, and it raised up itself on one side. Now, this beast right here is talking about the Medo-Persian Empire. It says, and it raised up on one side. Why? Because the Medes came in first, but the Persians towered over them. They actually became the greater of the two nations. So they became higher than the Medes. Even though the Medes reigned first, but the Persians took over. They became a greater nation. So it says, behold, another beast, a second like to a bear, and it raised up itself on one side, and it had three ribs in the mouth of it between the teeth of it, and they said thus unto it, arise, devour much flesh. After this I beheld, and lo, another like a leopard. Now this is the Greek Empire, which had upon the back of it four wings of a fowl, which are the four Alexander the Creep's four generals. The beast had also four heads, and dominion was given to it. So it took down the Medes and the Persians. And where was the first place that they took over from the Medes and the Persians? First off, they were in the land of Kittim. All right, now let's go from there to the book of First Maccabees, because that's where they came from. Because by at that time, Philip and, you know, the Edomites were already fighting to get up into Europe. And the first places that they took over was like in Kittim, and really in like Greece. Because they came out of Kittim, which they were there. But they were slowly but surely moving up in there, because going back to Haman, the Macedonian, he was plotting, he was a Edomite, a cracker, a Macedonian, and he was trying to get up into Europe and trying to take over the realm of the Persians and the Medes, but it didn't happen. Because he was trying to kill Mordecai, because Mordecai was going to expose his monkey ass, and the thing turned back and backfired on him, so he ended up getting put to death. That's why we celebrate today the Feast of Lots, which is Purim. So 1 Maccabees, the first chapter and the first verse, it says, and it happened after that Alexander, son of Philip, the Macedonian, who came out of the land of Kittim. Not that he was from that land, he came from that land. He was there. I mean, he may have been born there, I don't know. But the point is that that's where he came from. And it says when he came from there, he said he had smitten Darius, king of the Persians and the Medes, that he reigned in his stead, the first over Greece. So this was the first Edomite that reigned over Greece. Why they say that reigned over? Because the Greek, they already had kings among themselves. You know? So what happened was, it said that he reigned the first over Greece. The first what? The first Edomite over Greece. So this is a timeline of ancient Greece, right? Because Alexander the Creep, you know, he was the first Edomite to rule over Greece. Now, this is the ancient timeline of Greece. And you see here in 2800 BC, the doomed tombs in Crete, the Minoan civilization, which we read that the Minoan civilization, they were actually dark-skinned people, right? Those are the first inhabitants of Greece, you know, in that region, you know. And as you read on down through here, and around 670 BC, you have what's called here the first Greek coins are minted by King Gigas of Lydia. So these Japhites, you know, which is dark-skinned people, they already had kings that were ruling in Greece, you know, in those regions, you know. So Alexander the Creep was the first Edomite king to rule in Greece. That's why it said that, you know, that he was the first ruler of Greece, when we read in our the book of 1 Maccabees, the first chapter. Now, we're going to deal with this guy, King Gigas of Lydia, right? Now, this is from this website here, as you can see. And the other one, this is this website here. It's a timeline of ancient Greece. But this one here says the Lydians. About 687 BC, according to the Greek historian Herodotus, King Gigas started the new country of Lydia. And remember, Lydia is connected to the Minoans, it's connected to the Etruscans, it's connected to Japheth. And modern Turkey, where the Hittites had ruled before the Dark Ages. Now that the Assyrian Empire had collapsed and the Neo-Babylonians were not very strong, it was pretty easy for new countries to get started along the edges of the old empire. Gigas made his capital at the city of Sardis. For the time of Gigas, or Gyges, or however the hell you pronounce it, onward, the Lydians were pretty friendly with the Greek cities along the coast of Asia Minor, modern Turkey. The Greek word tyrant may be derived from the Lydian word for king, and coinage may also have gotten started here. Probably Greek soldiers fought as mercenaries for the Lydian kings. See, you had kings and Lydian kings. Alright, it says, in 560 BC, Croesus became the king of Lydia. Croesus, or Croesus, was so rich that he has left us the expression as rich as Croesus. Herodotus talks a lot about King Croesus, who he says was a friend of the Athenian Solon. According to Herodotus, King Croesus seems to be pretty much telling the Greek cities of Asia Minor what they can do. The Lydians seem to have had power over the Greek cities near them. So you had kings prior to Alexander the Creep, which is the Edomite, that ruled over Greece. You had kings among the real Japhites, the dark-skinned people that were already ruling in that region. You know, that's why when it turned over to Alexander's power, what happened was Alexander was the first Edomite to rule over Greece. You know, the first of those Edomite kings to rule over Greece. So it says, then in about 550 BC, Cyrus the Great attacked Lydia with the Persian army. Croesus apparently sent a messenger to the Greek oracle at Delphi, asking what he should do. The oracle said that if Croesus fought Cyrus, then a great kingdom would be destroyed. Croesus thought this meant that he would win, and so he fought Cyrus, but in fact Cyrus won, and Croesus realized that it was his kingdom that would be destroyed. In the end, Croesus and Cyrus seem to have made some sort of truce, but after the death of King Croesus in 546 BC, the Persians really took over Lydia, and soon they began to control the Greek cities nearby too. In 499 BC, the Greeks attempted to revolt and succeeded in burning the cities of Sardis, but by 491, the Greeks lost and came under Persian control. So from that time forward, Greece and those regions there went from Japhet, the dark-skinned Japhites there, to the control of the Persian Empire. And then later on down in the history, in the timeline of Greece, then that's when Alexander the Creep came up in there. That's why I said that he was the first ruler over Greece. All right. Now this is a book of 2 Corinthians 2:11. It says, "Lest Satan should get an advantage of us, for we are not ignorant of his devices." So the Lord, like the Elder Torah always says, the Lord gave us that spiritual, the Lord gave us a spiritual filter so that we're able to discern what's truth from what's lies. That's why it says here, "At least Satan should get an advantage of us, for we are not ignorant of his devices." And here in the book of Ecclesiasticus in the Apocrypha, Ecclesiasticus 5:15, "Be not ignorant of anything in a great matter or small." You know, so the Lord be revealing certain things to us, and we just do it to reveal it to you brothers, so you brothers can know that you know what we're telling you is the truth, you know. And those of you that can't get it, it's not meant for you. And those of you brothers that got it and already know it, then that's beautiful. But read that again. "And it happened after that Alexander, son of Philip the Macedonian, who came out of the land of Kittim, had smitten Darius, king of the Persians and the Medes." It's just like Elder Tar always said. It says like like here it calls him a Macedonian, but we know that the real Macedonians were dark-skinned people, right? But then when he came on there, he took over that region. So that's why they call him the Macedonian. It's just like the Seleucid Empire. They took over Syria, right? They call them Celo-Syrians. But are they really Syrians? No. The real Syrians were dark-skinned people. But they took over that region of land, so they called them that. They called them Syrians. But they were really Edomites. That's why Alexander was called a Macedonian. Why? Because he came out of that land. You know, not that he was actually from that land, but he came out of that land. You know, when they conquered it, because his father Philip was the one that conquered certain portions of land, but he didn't take over the whole known world. That was Alexander the Creep's job. So it says, "And it happened after that Alexander, son of Philip the Macedonian, who came out of the land of Kittim, had smitten Darius, king of the Persians and the Medes, that he reigned in his stead, the first over Greece." All right. And, you know, pretty much with that, I mean, that the point is pretty much made. You know, I had a couple more scriptures, but I just want to leave it at that, you know, so you brothers can meditate on that. And you can see that the people, the original people that inhabited that land of Europe was dark-skinned people, all right? And it's proven through the Minoans, through the Etruscans, through the Pelasgians or Pelagesians, and many others. All right, so with that, I hope you brothers learned something. Until the next time, I say shalom.